I am a bit nervous. This is my first talk on Zoom and maybe second in my life on Beamer, so we shall see how this goes. So I want to tell you about a joint project which we have with Pierre Colmez, and we started it about 2.5 years ago. It grew out from a collaboration with Gabriel Despinescu, where we were trying to compute P-adic etale cohomology or pro-etale cohomology of generic fibers of formal or weakly formal schemes with semi-stable reduction. So this is connected to conjectural or geometrization of conjectural P-adic Langlands correspondence. We just wanted to see what we can get. And here in this project, we don't assume we have semi-stable models, and we try to get some kind of idea what's the relationship between P-adic pro-etale cohomology and the Rham type of cohomology. We cannot really say anything about etale cohomology itself. It's too difficult for us at the moment. So let me start with reviewing the algebraic situation, which many of you are familiar with. So I am going to assume for simplicity that we have a finite extension K is a finite extension of QP, but it's not necessary for what I'm going to talk about. I will have the Galois group GK of K. C will be my CP, so algebraic closure, completed algebraic closure of QP. And a small k is going to be the residue field, which is perfect, and F will be the vid vectors. OF is the vid vectors of K, and F would be the, this is a typo here, it's the fraction field. So I'm going to state algebraic comparison theorem. So P-adic comparison theorem in a very general form. This form is due to Bailinson. So if you see here, I am not assuming, so X over K is an algebraic variety, and I'm not assuming it to be nor smooth nor proper. And then we claim that we have this kind of comparison theorems here to have two lines. And what are these objects? So on the left, we have P-adic etale cohomology. It's geometric. It's of X K bar. So it has Galois action. Then here, you can, if X has a good reduction and it's proper, then you can think of this, this is Hyodokato cohomology as crystalline cohomology, for example. And these BST are one of Bailinson Fontaine's period rings. Now in the second, so this is the PST comparison theorem, which base changes to the Rham comparison theorem. So we have again etale cohomology, and here we have the Rham cohomology. Now let me explain some more. So the Rham cohomology you take, because we have such a general situation, the Rham cohomology we take is the one of the Lin. So it uses resolution of singularities in its definition. And this line here, the Rham comparison is compatible with the Hodge filtration on everything. Now, the Hyodokato structure is a bit more complicated. It's defined by Bailinson, and I'm going to explain it on the next page. So it uses de Jong's alteration to reduce everything in H topology to semi-stable schemes. And it's going to have these structures here. So we'll have Frobenius, we'll have monodromy, which is nilpotent, and we will have action on it of GK, but this action is smooth. That is a stabilizer of every vector is going to be open subgroup of GK. And basically you can think of it as being the extension you have to make this model semi-stable if we had a potentially semi-stable reduction theorem. Okay, so how this works in real life. So you work locally in H topology on the generic fiber. So locally we can find so taking U, which maps by H map to X, we can find a semi-stable model script U over not OK itself, but some finite extension of OK. And in that, if you have this kind of picture here, then Hyodokato cohomology is just crystalline cohomology of the special fiber of this model over OFL. So this is the vid vectors of the residue field. And there is this funny structure. This is like a tangent structure. One goes to zero. You can think of this as some kind of, you want to think about this picture as a reduction from a line, for example. So it's a kind of deformation from a line, and your parameter t goes to zero, and it accounts for this subscript zero here. Anyway, that's not so important perhaps, but the important fact is that in the end, if you look at cohomology, you get finite rank objects. Sorry, so maybe I should assume also you to be, I should have said here, so let's assume that this script U is proper and semi-stable, okay? So it also has, U doesn't have to be proper, but this U will compactifies this U vertically, but also horizontally, okay? And we can do that, and again by de Jong. And then if you look at its cohomology, then the cohomology is a finite rank over FL, and it will have Frobenius and monodromy, and there will be some relation between these two structures. Moreover, if you base change, so there is this Hyodokato isomorphism, if you base change to L from this vid vector field here, you recover the Rham cohomology of, so everything is logarithmic, so the Rham cohomology is here logarithmic. I mean, the Rham cohomology is now natural, but here everything is logarithmic.
Quick question, what are the assumptions on X? Are any singularities allowed from the audience?
Yeah. Singularities are allowed because I allow this H map. If you start, as I will later in the analytic setup with X smooth, then everything here can be done by etal maps.
Okay.
So this, you can localize just in etal topology and you get the same picture. So okay. I think this improvement on the Young resolutions was done by Batt and Snowden some time ago. Okay, so this is what you get for the local pictures. You can think that in H topology we kind of compactify our objects, our open sets, vertically and horizontally, and we work with these compactifications. Okay, now we
So, how do you define the Hyodokato cohomology again, given this picture?
It's crystalline cohomology. I just defined this for this picture at the moment, okay? So it's okay. Crystalline cohomology of the special fiber of U as a logarithmic scheme over this OFL with this funny log structure, one goes to zero.
Uh-huh. Okay? And this a priori depends on U, but you want to get rid of this independence, is that the point?
You mean this U, this script U, yes.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's right. So this is what happens locally, and then you globalize it.
I see.
You form hypercover. So, okay, so let me explain what happens. So next point is globalization. So what do you do globally? So Bailinson extended the notion of Verdier basis for topology to something one may call Bailinson basis, in which the basis, the set of bases, is not fully embedded in the topology, but you allow more maps in the original topology than in the basis category. So here the basis will consist of this pairs here, so this U and its compactification. And the maps you will have, it will be maps of log schemes, basically. And that's, of course, a lot less than what you get on the generic fiber. And he proves, Bailinson proves in his paper, that this pairs form a basis. So you can compute with hypercovers built from such objects. And you can also define sheaves and everything using this kind of objects. So it works very well. So the only thing we have to, I will gloss over here is that we need to consider actually geometric Hildokato cohomology. So we have to go all the way up to K bar, but I will ignore this for a moment. And then we glue by this hypercovering procedures. And then what we get is a global object, which depends only on XK bar here, the geometric one. And it's now finite rank, but it's over F and R. So it's the non-ramified, maximal non-ramified extension of F. So you have to go a little bit up, and this accounts for all these field extensions here. You have Frobenius and monodromy, and now you also kind of remember where you became semi-stable, so to speak. And moreover, you have this comparison with the Rham cohomology, the Hildokato morphism, what we are saying is that the Rham cohomology acquires these extra structures coming from the special fiber, really, via this isomorphism. Okay, so this is, I wanted to do it in more detail than maybe I should have, but just because in the analytic setup, this situation is going to be very, very similar, a little bit more difficult maybe. Okay, so how do we restate this algebraic comparison theorem? So we can think of them as going two ways, from the Rham structures to etale comparison. To etale cohomology, this is typo. So we have etale cohomology, which can be recovered from the Rham cohomology. You have these period rings here. Then we have filtration zero of the Rham part and Frobenius equal one and equal zero part of the Hildokato twist here. And this is compatible with Galois action. Okay, otherwise, we can also say that we have this the presentation we like, that you have this bicartesian diagram here. You see, so you have etale cohomology here, filter the Rham structures here, the Rham structures here, and some Hildokato structures here. Okay, and again, if you don't want to think about this complicated object here, just think about crystalline cohomology of a special fiber in good reduction. And I will have to shorthand it because this is just way too many symbols. So I will write this for etale, this for filter, this for the Rham, and this for Hildokato. The upper index, I will have to vary the indices. The upper index refers to cohomology and the lower to twists. Okay, so, and what does it mean by Cartesian? So in plain language for us, it will mean that this sequence is exact. Okay, so that's what we want. So this is the way I will remember the algebraic comparison. Okay, and the other way, if you start with etale cohomology, you can get to the Rham cohomology. And the formula is the following. So I wrote it on purpose this way because that's the way we can do it analytically. So you look at etale cohomology, you take morphisms to the period ring BST, and you look at morphisms which are stable by some open subgroup. That's what it means here, open subgroup of GK, okay? And then I should get a dual of Hildokato with all the structures again. I recover these structures, Frobenius, monodromy, and Galois action from the left-hand side. And same goes for the Rham cohomology. But here I take all equivariant maps into Bideram, and I get something compatible with filtration. Okay, so this is all I wanted to say about the algebraic situation. So this is more or less classical by now. There are many proofs, and the structures many constructions we base in the analytic setting are actually coming from the work from the proof of Billingson. Okay, so now let's pass to the analytic varieties. So I'm going to talk about smooth rigid analytic varieties, and maybe I will assume, and I will just say now and then forget about this, some finiteness conditions. So maybe I want them to be connected, paracompact and countable at infinity or something like that. What I want is that I can cover my variety, as you will see, that's the way we argue, by an increasing sequence of quasi-compact varieties. They don't have to be strictly included in each other, but just include. Okay, so let's discuss what's going on in rigid analytic setup. So as in the algebraic setup, well, let me just mention it again. Here, all the groups, all the cohomology groups were finite. These were finite QP vector spaces, finite FNR vector spaces, and finite K-bar vector spaces. So of course we lose this finiteness completely in the rigid analytics setup. But in the proper case, we actually are better off. So this was the case studied by Scholze, who proved that if you look at the Talco homology geometric with QP, then coefficients, then it is a finite rank over QP. So how you prove a theorem, how he proved this theorem? He uses Artin-Schreier sequence to pass to coherent cohomology. And now he works with coherent cohomology and he mimics the old, tries to mimic the old arguments of Cartier-Serre for finiteness of coherent cohomology. So that works very well. We also have in this setup Hodge the Ram spectral sequence, which degenerates. And Scholze proves that we get the Ram comparison isomorphism. So the second sequence we had there. So we have a Talco homology and the Ram cohomology. Again, they are finite. And they are in this period relationship with this ring Bideram. And everything is compatible with filtration. So at least we have that. That's already a lot. And then, but you can do a do better in this setup in the proper case. If you mimic Baylinson's constructions, but to define Hedokato cohomology, but instead of using De Jong's alterations, we use Hartle and Temkin alterations. So Hartle did it, I think. I'm not sure we really need, well, maybe we need Temkin as well. But basically what they show is that for a tal, because I started with something smooth, so for a tal topology on the generic fiber, we can find these local models which are semi-stable, but semi-stable now just means vertically semi-stable. We are not compactifying anything horizontally at all. So they're still really, quote-unquote, big rigid analytic varieties. And using that, and then I sketched the proof, okay. So we can prove both potentially semi-stable and the Ram comparison with Colmez. And Hedokato cohomology is defined again using this Hartle and Temkin. The Ram it's known. So you have the very similar statement as in the algebraic setup. So I want to sketch to you just in two sentences how do you prove this kind of thing? Okay, so we are using the syntomic method to prove it. So the first step. It uses, in fact, all the results of Tsuji and Kato and some reinterpretation of them in my joint work with Colmez, which showed that P-adic nearby cycles, because that's what you really want to, you are computing when you compute this Talco homology here, P-adic nearby cycles can be computed by syntomic cohomology. Now, syntomic cohomology is some kind of derived Frobenius filtered eigenspace of crystalline cohomology. So it's something built from this Hedokato, as it turns out, the Ram, etc. And this theorem tells you that these two things are quasi-isomorphic, but so these are complexes, but up to degree R. So this is kind of a condition familiar for motivic people, of course, and which appears everywhere, this kind of stability condition. So after some reductions, what you get is almost the sequence we want. So you get filtered the Ram, you get this Hedokato fellow you like the Ram, but the next object is syntomic homology in degree R plus one twisted by R, And the previous object here is this, the Ram guy in the grid R minus one. So you want to show that these two maps F R minus one and F R R zero to have our comparison there. Okay, so why would they be zero? And here we use a trick, which is very cute, I think. So we lifted everything. I will explain what I mean by that, but I lifted everything to a category of Banach-Colmez. We lifted everything to the category of Banach-Colmez spaces. And so this category is quite rigid in the sense that there is less morphisms in this category than you would naively perhaps guess. And in particular, we get that these morphisms here, FR minus one, FR have to be zero. So how do you get it for, how do you argue for FR minus one? So in Banach-Colmez spaces, and again, I will say a few words about this in a moment, every object comes equipped with a total dimension. This dimension has a big dimension, which is a dimension of a CP vector space, so to speak, and a small dimension, which we also call height, which is the dimension of a QP part. So if you look at this object here, might be modeled by the filtered fellow, it only has CP dimension, it will not have any height, it will not have any QP dimension. On the other hand, by Scholza, we know that the Talco homology is finite rank over QP, so it has the height, but it doesn't have any CP dimension. And then the theory of Banach-Colmez spaces tells you that this map, which you now lifted to this category, has to be zero. And with this is a bit, to deal with the second map is a bit more difficult. You have to twist and untwist and reduce basically to this situation. But that's the main idea. So it's a little bit of a magic, I think, because one thing it allows us to do is to completely avoid Poincaré duality. So you don't have to use any Poincaré duality. Usually in this p-adic isomorphism, you constructed comparison morphism, and then you wanted to argue that it's an isometry for Poincaré duality. But that's not what we do here, and it's good because in other setups, we don't have Poincaré duality. Okay, so now I am going to digress. So what are these Banach-Colmez spaces? You see them a lot in modern mathematics, actually more and more. So here I had these objects, like for example, I had this Hyodokato object here. So this object, Hyodokato object was Hyodokato tensor BST plus n equals zero, phi equal one. And the question is what structure I can put on this object. So we know that Hyodokato, at least in this case we were interested in, is finite rank, but this BST plus is something big. So
quick question, sorry. Akhil was asking if you could clarify how you make these statements work without a proper semi-stable model. Since it seems it's necessary for the finiteness statements.
For which sequence?
I guess for this.
Sorry, I guess I was just wondering if, so,
thanks.
Right, so this argument, what you were explaining, it relies on the finiteness of, well, it uses the sequence that comes from syntomic cohomology, which, I understand correctly, needs a semi-stable model, but then you're using the finiteness of a Talco homology, which, oh, but I guess that only depends on the, well, I don't know, I guess, yeah, I was wondering, do you have a?
No, in fact, I should have said this sequence is now global, okay? Mm-hmm. So I am on X, which is proper and smooth over K, for example, and that's the sequence I get.
But so just to clarify, the syntomic cohomology is defined without a model.
Yeah, so we define syntomic cohomology by the same procedure as I explained for Hyodokato cohomology, okay? So you find this, you look at these local models, In this case, there will be formal schemes with semi-stable reduction. And so you think of them as logarithmic schemes, and you can define syntomic complexes for those. And then you globalize in a tal topology. You have to prove that these objects, the semi-stable models, form a base, but that's the same argument as in Bailey's and really.
Thank you.
But how do you get HIE tau is finite dimensional without properties?
It is proper. My X is proper.
Oh, sorry.
So I guess the point is that to make the definitions, you're using local semi-stable models.
That's right.
But only the global properness is needed to then prove that these are all finite.
Yes.
Okay.
What do you mean all is finite? Etal cohomology is finite, yes.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. You can think of these local models as some kind of charts, right? So locally you take some charts being a base means that you can define your sheaves on these models, and that's good enough. Okay, so I was talking about this object BST plus you see here. And if you look at BST plus and you take n equals zero, then you get B crisp plus. Okay, you kill the took the n equals zero part. And then if you take F equal P part, so what kind of object it is? We have this fundamental sequence of P-adic Hodge theory, right? You have QPT, that's the Tate element. And you have this eigenspace. And then you have C, which was our CP, in fact, in this case. So in some sense, you want to say that the B crisp plus Phi equal P is like QP plus C in some word. So the question is in which word? So more generally, you can take eigenspace phi equal pm, and then you have QP vector space in the kernel again, generated by T to m twist, and here you would have Biderman plus mod tm. So this fellow here, Biderman plus mod tm, is an extension of C, m copies of C. So we could think of this as C to power m, and then again QP, which corresponds to this part. But again, in which category this would make sense? So if you look naively at category of topological vector spaces, then in fact you have isomorphism of this sort, so it's not a really very good category, and you can construct such isomorphism easily because recall that p-adically Banach spaces, so we are in the category of QP Banach spaces, and Banach spaces p-adically have bases, so they behave like Hilbert spaces, and here you just are adding one element to the basis. Okay, so this is not a good category, but a good category exists. It was constructed by Colmez and Fontaine. So it is called the category of Banach-Colmez vector spaces. So morally speaking, these are finite dimensional C vector spaces plus minus finite dimensional QP vector spaces. So you are allowed, like in this example here, you are allowed to mod out by QP vector space. So that's why you get that corresponds to minus. Okay, and then you have this total dimension. So it's a dimension of the C part and the Q part, QP part, and the dimension of QP part I will call height. It is called height. And the non-trivial theorem here is that this total dimension is additive on short exact sequences. Actually, we use that all the time in our arguments, okay? So that's very important. So I want to look at examples. So we mentioned Biderman plus mod tm. So this, we think of this as cm, c points of a vector space, which we call bm, which has now dimension m, zero corresponds to the zero height. Now, here, the third example, we have C mod QP, So C corresponds to BC space, which I will call V1 and mod QP. So we have dimension 1 and minus 1. Minus 1 corresponds to modding out QP. And here it's a little bit more complicated eigenspace, kind of fractional, which we call UAB, and it has dimension B and height A. Okay, so these are very, so these are basically the standard examples, okay, which appear very often. Okay, so so this was to explain perhaps a part of this argument in our proof here for the proper case. And this is also something which we use in the rest of the proofs. So after proper case, the next case which was kind of analyzed was the case of Stein variety. So I just want to remind you what it means to be Stein. So X over K is Stein. So we can cover, we have an admissible covering by affinoids. And for example, the one property we are going to use is that the coherent cohomology is acyclic. So HI of coherent sheaf vanishes in non-zero degrees. But in practice also, if you look at how do you compute pro-etale cohomology, you just compute it on each of these affinoids, but then pro-etale is equal to etale. So you just compute the usual etale cohomology, and then you go to the limit over these coverings. So this is the way we work in practice with these spaces. And this is the way we will work with general spaces, only that these coverings are going to be of different nature. So I want to look at examples before I look at examples before the break, and then I'll do the theorem. So the example, so that's the way we went, of course, because we had no idea what these objects are. So we started to do examples. So we started here with analytic, say analytic affine line. And then you see that the pro-etale cohomology, here's R twist. This R twist is just because I assume my X comes from finite from K. So there is some Galois action on everything. And what you get here is a huge space, but it has a reasonable description, right? So it's R minus one differentials modulo the kernel in the Rham complex. So for example, for H1, you get functions mod global functions mod C. Okay, so that's the affine space. So you can see that the affine space is not acyclic, I mean, by the way. Now, what happens for the torus? So this is just the one-dimensional torus. So you get this, this here is like a C part. So you think of this as a C object, so to speak. So you still get this C object here again. It's global functions mod C, but you get now a new thing, which is a QP vector space of rank one. And the action on GK is on everything, but it's trivial on this thing. So this comes from the period of GM. Okay, so that's another example. Now what happens for the Drinfeld half plane? So so it's a rigid analytics space, which is projective space in dimension one, and then you take out all the irrational points. It has a rigid analytic structure. And again, you have this C part here, which is the same form, in fact, O mod C. But now here you have, before you had one rank one space, but here you have something huge, in fact. So you have Steinberg representation smooth of GL2 K. So these are locally constant functions on PK with values in QP mod constants on a dual of this. So this already gets complicated. You have kind of huge spaces both on the C side and the QP side. So this is the remark I want to make here, is that pro-etale cohomology is in general infinite, as you can see. But also, of course, Hodge-Deram spectral sequence does not degenerate. Okay, so With Gabriel, so with Colmez and Dospinescu, we proved, well, I mean, more or less proved this theorem. So that if you, so generalization or general form of these examples, if you start with Stein smooth rigid analytic space, but also it could be overconvergent if you know it. So this is the first time I talk about this, and but this will appear later a lot. We use overconvergent structure to control topology. We don't really know how to control topology well otherwise. So we overconverge our structure shifts, which forces certain cohomology groups to be finite. And in these two setups, we get a diagram like that. So we get we get two exact sequences, top and bottom, connected by these maps. So let me explain maybe. So we have pro-etale cohomology. So everything is a cohomology of XC. I removed XC because it was too much. So you have this pro-etale cohomology. On the left, you have this C part coming from differentials. And here again, you have this QP part, this coming from Hyodokata cohomology, it turns out. So this Steinberg representation here, and the before the period space, I mean, they come from this kind of object. So it's some eigenspace of Hyodokata cohomology twisted by period ring. And now at the bottom, you just have a piece of the Rham complex, right? You have D equals zero closed forms. You have this part here, and then the Rham cohomology. So it's a very simple diagram, and actually we managed to use it to prove some useful things in certain setups. So I want to mention that what's going on here. So there are two statements. I guess we say that this diagram here is bicartesian, kind of like we said before, but we also identify this kernel here, right? And we also say that this map here is surjective.
So quick question. What is the R decorating the completed tensor product?
Yeah, so I need to mention that. Unfortunately, I'm sorry, but this is, okay, so I meant to mention this later, but maybe I can do as well. Okay, so topology. So everything is done in the category of locally convex spaces, okay? So this is quasi-abelian category. It has reasonable homological algebra. You can, the derived category is not so horrible. It has, there is a T structure, and the hard is quite reasonable. So you just work with that hard basically. Now the tensor products I take are all projective, which just means that they commute with limits. We chose that type. Versus those two commute with collimits. So they commute with limits, and unfortunately they are not exact. They are left exact, so there is a right derived functor. Okay. And now here in this picture, the R refers to this derived functor, but because I am Stein or overconvergent, this in fact is just concentrated in one degree, this guy here. Maybe you have to put a, so for those who know period rings, BST plus is not very nice ring to work with. It's a polynomial algebra, it's not very good for computations of this type of computation. So you replace it often with B hat plus ST, which is a Banach space, and then it's much better. So that's what you do, in fact. So I'm sorry, but in this setup, topology actually is a real nightmare, but you have to deal with it. Okay. So.
Sorry, one more question from Akhil. So the Rham and Hyodokata cohomology are taken in this category of locally convex spaces?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yes.
But here they are very nice. So the reason for that is that if you, Stein space is overconvergent naturally. So you can write it as a union also of not just affinoids, but overconvergent affinoids, okay? And for overconvergent affinoid, the Rham cohomology and Hyodokata cohomology are going to be finite. So if this is just a dagger over, so dagger means over convergence, on dagger affinoid, Hyodokato and the Rham are finite.
Okay.
These guys, of course, are not, they're still big. But here, this picture here looks very nice. Now, if it's for Stein, all you do is have to go to the limit of with these finite objects to get the cohomology of Stein spaces. So it's a Frechet now, but Frechet a very nice type. In fact, it's a product of finite objects. So topologically, you are quite safe here.
And one, thank you. One last question from Tony Scholl. What sort of dual is the dual that appears of the Steinberg representation at the top of the slide?
Yeah, I think it's just an algebraic dual here.
Okay, thanks.
I think maybe it's a natural point to stop because then I discuss the main theorem, which is generalization, maybe.
Very good. So thank you. And Moreau will break us into breakout rooms.
That's the second part of my talk, and I wanted to state the main theorem. So we stated for smooth varieties which we overconverge. So these are rigid analytic varieties with overconvergent structure. And again, this is done mostly for topological reasons and for handling locally small objects, as you will see. So we have the Rham-to-etale comparison. So we claim that we can prove that there exists a bicartesian diagram of this form, which is very similar to the one you saw before, that is in the algebraic setting. So now instead of etale, you have here pro-etale. And here you have Hyodokato and BST plus and phi equal PR n equals zero component again. Here you have to take these topological derived products. Here you have the Rham fellow. The difference is here. And so it's first you take Arger complex of the Rham cohomology. Then you tensor it with B Rham plus. Then you take a filtration of that, and then you take a homology of that. And this is to handle this is the right form, really. The other one, which you've seen in the proper case, resulted from the degeneration of the Hodge-Rham spectral sequence. Okay, so, and the other way, so from etale to the Rham, we have similar formulas as before. We'll ignore this pro-smooth. It's some kind of pro-analog of smooth morphisms. And then you have basically the same formula. So the dual of Hyodokato can be recovered with all its structures from pro-etale by mapping it to BST. And the Rham with filtration. So here is the naive filtration. So I put these question marks because we are not completely sure how to formulate the filtration part of this theorem, but this statement here is correct. So you just put the naive filtration, meaning the image filtration on the Rham, and then you have this kind of statement, so you can recover it from pro-etale. Maybe we have to upgrade this statement a bit in the future. So remarks. So as I was mentioning, in the proper case, we just had this kind of object before. Now we have this kind of object. And this is because we had in the proper case, we have degeneration of Hodge-Rham spectral sequence. And also in the proper case, what we had was that these arrows here, the horizontal arrows are injective, okay? And now if you go to the other case, which is Stein or affinoid, it's the opposite. The horizontal arrows are surjective and we can identify the kernels as these spaces of differentials. So in fact, the statement for Stein that we have is implies this statement, but it's more refined, it's stronger. It also characterizes this kernel here. So topology, I already mentioned a little bit. So the overconvergence implies that we have good properties. So higher direct functors of tensor product vanish, and that's what we want. That's not always the case, but that's case when in the cases we want. And also, I forgot to mention that I say here cohomology is classical. So if you have quasi-abelian category like the category of locally convex topological vector spaces, you embed it into in the left heart, say, which is now like a pair of objects with a map. So everything we do with is actually a this kind of pair. We work in this category of these pairs. Classical just means that you just have one object, so you are reduced, you are back in the original category. So everything here that you will see is in fact classical. Okay, so I want to sketch now the proof of this theorem. So the first sentence is equip everything inside with Banach-Colmez structure. Okay, so that's actually not very trivial. So if you look at these objects, every one of them can be equipped with Banach-Colmez structure, but it's not a completely trivial question to make sure that all the maps are maps in this category. So that requires some work. Excuse me, can I interrupt just like a second, okay? Someone was knocking to the door. Okay, so I was going to say, if you don't want to work with the category of Banach-Colmez structures, there is an easy way out, that is we can work in the category of Fontaine's almost CP representations. Only then that you have to assume that the residue field of your field is finite, and so that gives us a restriction because there are some Euler characteristic computations of Galois cohomology. Okay, so the next step of the proof is reduction to quasi-compact space. We want to do that because we want certain cohomologies to be finite. So that's reasonably simple. So we write our space as a union of increasing quasi-compact objects, un in un plus one. This is just increasing. There is no assumptions on this inclusion. So we want to prove, so this is what we want. We want to prove that this sequence Cx is exact, right? So you have etal object, Hyodokato object, filtered the Rham object and the Rham, and this sequence should be exact. So it's enough to prove that this sequence is just the limit of sequences on finite level here for every un, where you would know by assumption the theorem. And to prove that this equality here is true, we use, since we are already in BC spaces, we use that there is a Mittag-Leffler in this category. You have finiteness, but it's not a finiteness of QP vector spaces because you have something like CP, but it's as good, in fact, so you can use that. Okay, so now we are in the setup where your Dagger space is quasi-compact. So that's actually already quite nice, because now you look at this pair Hyodokato and the Rham, and now you have objects which are finite rank. So Hyodokato is finite rank over FNR, and the Rham is finite rank over C. So what we state here as a lemma is that our theorem, our main theorem, is equivalent to this three, to each, well, okay. This is not very well formulated here. So one, two, three are all equivalent, and they are equivalent to our main theorem, okay? So the first sentence is that this pair Hyodokato de Rham, so basically you think of the Rham with some extra structure, is acyclic. I will explain what it means. So this is a working terminology for us, but I think it's not so bad. Then another equivalent statement is that the pro-etale cohomology is effective. So that's which is equivalent, I mean, which by which we mean that it has positive non-negative signature. And here we are not so sure about this terminology, but anyway, we use it for the moment. That's the best we found. And the third sentence is that the height of pro-etale cohomology is the same as the Rham dimension. So you see what happens here, the Rham cohomology is finite now. So you can just talk about this dimension, but pro-etale cohomology is not going to be finite because in this theorem, if you see on the left, you have this object here and this object is going to be big. This filtered object, it will include things like this omega, like this kind of objects. So pro-etale will have some non-trivial huge CP dimension, but we are still saying that its QP dimension is just going to be equal to the dimension of the Rham cohomology, just like in the proper case for the total etale cohomology. So this should be true in all these sentences, claims for all R. So it's not the case, I want to warn you, it's not the case that if you fix R, then all of these guys are equivalent. That's not the case. There is some complicated circular, I mean, reasoning going by induction on R. Okay, so when we realized that, because we had several approaches to our main theorem and we tried to prove it for partially proper and none of our approaches worked, geometric approaches. We tried to fiber it over a space and over a Stein space and use some standard techniques, but in fact, we don't have these techniques. The technology in this area is still not well developed well enough for us to use this kind of technique, so we couldn't do it. And then we decided to write what do we really say in this theorem. And once we saw this number three here, that the height is equal to dimension, the proof kind of it kind of was almost clear what one has to do. So this is what I want to tell you. I won't tell you how the real proof goes. I just tell you how. What was the guiding idea for the proof? But before doing that, maybe I should explain what it means to be acyclic and what is this effective thing here. So next page. So we have this pair. This is the Rham object. This is the Hyodokato structure. And we call it acyclic if the associated vector bundle on the Fark-Fontaine curve is acyclic. That is, it doesn't have H1, okay? So that's why the name acyclic is. In plain language, this you can just take for definition the third line. I mean, these three lines are equivalent. So you can take the third line, and in practice for computations, that's what we use. We use the third line, this algebraic characterization. The second characterization is that vector bundle has the Hardener Sima slopes non-negative. I think I got the sign right here. So one remark I want to make is the following: if you look at this, so now we have a quasi-compact overconvergent object. So in particular, it could be proper, right? So then it's just a proper object and. Then this pair, Hyodokato-Rham, is weakly admissible in the filtered phi n module because we have a comparison theorem a la Fontaine for this pair. And then we know that its slopes, in fact, it's semi-stable, the associated vector bundle is semi-stable of slope zero. So in our terminology, it is acyclic. So what we are saying here is that we get, in fact, more general objects, but still not quite random. That is, we have this condition that the vector bundle has trivial H1. So this is one property we found. And now the signature. So I wrote here what we define as for BC space to have W to have negative signature to be to have signature equal zero and positive signature. So negative signature, that means that if you take morphism into C, so CP, but as a BC space, that this home, this morphism, this home is zero. So this is not quite equivalent, but it follows, for example, if the associated vector bundle, if you take a vector bundle on the Farquharson curve and you look at H1, then it has this property. It is a BC space W, which will be of signature negative. Okay, and positive, it means we have injection into Biderand D. So you can think of it as something like H0 of a vector bundle. And now signature zero, it means it's a successive extension of C or CP. And geometrically it's H0 of a coherent sheaf, which is supported at infinity and its torsion. Okay. And so this is a couple of remarks and examples I wanted to make. So effective means that we are of signature greater equal zero. So basically you have to think about something that embeds into Biderand plus module, okay? And this negative signature means that there is no morphism into Biderand plus, but maybe that you can ignore for the lecture. So examples here, C or V1, so C itself has signature zero and height zero, no QP component. Now C mod QP has negative signature and height minus one because you modded out QP. Now the eigenspace here has positive signature and height one. Why is height one? Height one, which again comes from the sequence, fundamental exact sequence. Now, if you mod out this QPT, which is the height, you get something of signature zero and height zero. But if you mod out QPX for any other element in outside of QPT, you get negative signature and height zero. So we are not quite convinced this signature is a terribly good name and terribly good notion, but it seems to work for us at the moment. So what we want is this to say that pro-etale cohomology has this non-negative signature, that is that it can be embedded into Biderand plus, basically. Okay. One more remark I wanted to make is that at the moment I talk about BC spaces here, but of course our BC space I mentioned to you were extensions of CP plus minus QP space, a CP space, finite rank plus minus finite rank QP space. But here we will have huge objects as far as the CP dimension, the C dimension goes. So we actually work in something which we call quasi BC category, in which the C component is replaced by Biderand plus mod TM module.
Quick question from David Hansen. Is the signature a shadow of a numerical invariant, or is it just a sign including zero?
Good question, I don't know.
Thanks.
In fact, yeah, it's a good question. It's kind of related to what we do in a moment. So I don't know. I mean, it's possible that there is something better, and this is just a numerical.
One more question from Eldon. Do you use Lebras results to make sense of these over the Farquharson curve or something else?
We definitely use Lebras results in the paper. I'm not sure that we needed them in this place, but maybe as well, but we use them in the paper.
Okay, next.
At some point, I think we need computation of X groups, and he computed some of the X groups.
Very good.
But yes, But again, maybe this signature thing. I mean, so we are still working out the best definition here. Okay, so what we want to prove, as I mentioned, is this claim number three, that is that the height of proetale is the same as the Rham dimension. Okay, and now, but now X is quasi-compact, so this dimension is finite, so we want also that this height here is finite, but also that it's positive, right? So this is true for affinoids by this theorem, which I stated before as an example, which was for Stein and affinoids. So you can get it from there, and this is clearly true. So we have it for affinoids. So now you could do induction. You are in quasi-compact case. You can do induction on the number of affinoids that you use to cover your X. So that's basically what we do. So let's just do the case of two affinoids. So we cover with two affinoids. Okay. Now, one remark I want to make, that if you look at this Hyodokato object that we have over there, then its height is the same as the dimension of the Rham. That's basically, that follows basically from the fundamental exact sequence, if you look carefully. So we can replace this statement we want, the Rham dimension equal height, to the Hyodokato height is equal to the same height as proetale. We can replace it like that. And then you can reduce, this basically says that if we look at the map, the top map in our diagram from proetale to the Hyodokato, that if height were a functor from BC spaces to an abelian category, and this functor were exact, we actually, well, I don't even think we need exactness at this point, but we need it later. But what we want to show, that this morphism induces isomorphism on heights. That's what we want to prove. Okay. And now it's clear what to do, right? We do Meyer-Vietoris for this covering. We have the top row here is these are the proetale objects. The bottom row are the Hyodokato objects. You have the maps in the top of the horizontal maps from the basic diagram. These two maps and these two maps are quasi-isomorphism, or isomorphism in this case by the inductive hypothesis, so to speak. So you end up with this being an isomorphism by 5 lemma. So it's very simple, right? Only that height is not as it is. It's not an exact functor into an abelian category. I don't know, maybe one can make it into an exact functor into something quasi-abelian and argue with that with all your characteristic later. I don't know. But what we did instead is that I try to use a fancy name here, categorification of height. It's partial categorization of height. Okay. So instead of height, we consider a functor from BC spaces to Biderham modules. Okay. Biderham is a field, so this is really just into some vector spaces of Biderham. And the functor is just home functor. So if we start with something effective, then it turns out that it does represent the height. That is, the height is going to be equal to the rank, be the Rham rank of this H functor. Okay, so that's pretty good. In general, you will have the X appearing there. And we prove that, well, this is kind of, well, we prove that H is an exact functor on effective BC spaces. So we have what we want. So We can use the argument I sketched with Meyer-Vietoris and 5 lemma as soon as we know that everything we want inside is effective. Okay, so we know it for all affinoids, or by this example for affinoids, or by inductive hypothesis if we iterate. Now for this Hyodokato term, this should be, yeah, for the Hyodokato term, we also know it because this embeds in a Biderham plus object, which is, I mean, Biderham tensor, the Rham cohomology. So this is effective. Now, how do we argue on this for this proetal object? So now we argue on induction by induction on R. So we start with assuming that Hyodokato theorem give us an acyclic object in degree R minus one. So you can start at zero if you like, for example. And that we argue by some diagram chases and properties of BC spaces that gives us effectiveness of proetal. And once you have effectiveness of proetal, you actually also have acyclicity of HR, Hyodokato HR theorem. So that basically finishes the proof. Okay, so thank you.
Okay, let's thank the speaker. Well, let me just ask from Xijing Li one question that came up a moment ago. They asked, what's the signature of the direct sum of something with positive and something with negative signature?
Direct sum. I'm going to ask Pierre. Pierre, direct sum of something with negative and positive signature. What signature does it have?
Okay. So the signature is not defined for every object.
Signature is not defined for all R W's. Okay, so that's right. So what we have in the paper, this is coming from Pierre, who wrote that part. He says that you can filter all the objects. There is a three-step filtration, and I forget which way it goes. You have signature positive equals zero, and then negative signature. So there is a canonical filtration on any BC space such that in the gradings belong to one of the three categories.
Okay. That's very helpful, thanks. Are there other questions? Well,
I guess it's sort of a basic background question that was refused earlier. So I guess in particular, you're saying that, if I understand correctly, you're using that, saying that if you have a quasi QCQS rigid variety, then its QP cohomology has the structure of a BC space. So if I
proetal, you mean?
Right. Sorry. Mm-hmm. Yes. So should I think of this? So if I understand correctly, a BC space can be viewed as sort of a sheaf on the category of perfectoid spaces. And is this going to be the sheaf that takes a perfectoid C algebra to take the proetal cohomology of the base change of the variety to
that that's right. So for proetal, that's right. So for proetal, you can do what you are just saying, and that gives you a structure of what I guess Colmez calls in his papers maybe vector space with big V and big F, you know, and then you can do something, so that's fine. I think that just works fine. And then in this diagram, to get this diagram, he of course should be symptomic cohomology. Okay? Mm-hmm. So you can do similar constructions, I think. Well, you can do similar constructions for symptomic if you express it as a cone of this kind of objects. Okay, but then you have a comparison theorem between this symptomic object and this proetal, and so far at least I am not convinced. Pierre says he has some argument which proves that this is a morphism of vector spaces in his language, this comparison theorem, but I am not convinced at the moment yet. So if you like to think in which category it really works at the moment, you can think of almost CP representations of Fontaine, and that's fine. because everything has that almost CP structure by definition, basically.
Thank you.
So there's a question from the chat from Yue Fang, which I hope I understand. So I guess the question is, does your construction give an adic K-theoretic interpretation of Banach-Colmez spaces?
Maybe the question is the other way around. I mean, isn't the question that maybe K-theory spaces have a natural structure, BC structures?
I can't speak to what they asked without further clarification. So answer the question however you would like to.
Our
theorem. Not confident about.
Pardon me.
I'm not much confident about how to rephrase the question to further clarify it, but just please answer. Yeah.
Yes.
How to is there any kind of algebraic theory to inference the BC category?
Okay, I'm not sure. Now you confused me completely. So, because now it sounded like you wanted to do K theory with the BC category, and
well, I guess we can.
Okay.
Say,
I thought the question was about something else because so let me mention something maybe that. I stated all of this for Dagger varieties.
Uh-huh.
But, some time ago, so we have a paper coming where we do computation just in dimension one, so for analytic curves. Mm-hmm. And then we have some theorem for affinoids of dimension one. And if you compute things for affinoids in dimension one, you have to be careful what you mean by any of these objects. Then you see some Milner K coming out. Naturally in this setup.
Great. Are there any other questions?
Yeah, I have a question. If I'm audible.
Please. Please.
I have a question about your main theorem. So you always take QPR, where R is the degree of cohomology.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm.
Can you say anything about what
Yeah, so if anyone remembers, I don't know whether Tony you were there, but last week Pierre gave a talk at Oberwolfach about the same subject, maybe he stressed different things. So in his talk, basically you can, so instead of HRR, you can take HIR, okay? Mm-hmm. So you have I here, R here. And I has to be in the usual range, so I has to be less equal to R. And now, and you still have this diagram. Okay. And what happens in higher degrees, I have no idea. I tried to compute some time ago examples for syntomic, what happens to syntomic cohomology. So for if you plug in syntomic here, then you get a long exact sequence still. And you can look, for example, at what happens at syntomic cohomology 3 with twist 2 or something like that. And then if you took something like product of two elliptic curves with semi-stable reduction, no, with super singular reduction, then you had a CP coming from the left here. It was not zero, and it was CP, in fact, not QP. It was for proper, so you have proper smooth varieties. And you have a CP coming, so I don't know. I don't know what's going on. Somehow it sees this super singular reduction in higher degrees.
Any other questions? I guess I had one, which is about this slide, thankfully. So from in Rham-to-pro-etale, you really recover the pro-etale cohomology from the Rham and Hirokato cohomologies.
Mm-hmm.
But in the Etale to Durham, you're recovering the duals. And I guess that these are not finite dimensional or dualizable, or they are?
No, in general, they're not finite dimensional. So in general, it's going to be, because we are overconvergent again, this is a product of finite dimensional. It is actually a product of finite dimensional. It's a limit of finite dimensional. So at the moment, this thing here you take, it's taken naively as some kind of limit of naive duals or something of that sort. But as I was saying, I think we don't know yet this part here. Maybe the first line is almost correct, but you would like to recover this factor here, you know. So it would have things like omega r minus 1, d equals 0 maybe, or mod ker d. Some of them we can recover with our techniques, but we don't know exactly what statement to make here, you know, at the moment. We don't know. Maybe everything has to be derived in some way. I don't know.
Okay. Thanks. Okay, any last questions?
Yeah, I do want to ask something. So is there an integral version of this result?
We don't even know whether we can do anything with etale here instead of pro-etale. And the reason is that if you do pro-etale, you can compute always with rational P-adic theory. If you try to do etale, you have to you basically have to compute integrally or up to some control denominators. And this nice form, for example, we get here with the Hyodokato, that basically, so I don't know how to replace this corner here. So in the integral case, because to write it in this way, we actually have to allow denominators of any size.
Uh-huh. But there is such a thing as integral Hyodokato cohomology, right? I mean,
yeah, it's not the problem is not with Hyodokato. The problem is with getting this long exact sequence.
Right?
So you have, of course, an integral Hyodokato. You have all of these objects, but naturally, what you get here, this thing from comparison theorem is crystalline cohomology of if you have a model of your X. Yes, OC over A Chris. This is phi equal PR. This is the object here. Then you have to pass from this object, this crystalline cohomology over A Chris, to this Hyodokato tensor period ring. And it's this passage which introduces high denominators.
I see.
Or at least that's, and we tried it, but we couldn't do it. So we tried it even in the case of the Driffeld space, which has a very nice model, and we couldn't do it. So in this kind of way, so we had to use this integral P-adic theory of Badmorow, Schultz, and Chesnavitz, Koshikawa.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Okay. Any other last questions? If not, let's thank the speaker again. Thank you. And we'll return in 2 weeks for the talk of Sandra Coopers.